Welcome to the Living History series of the DC Charter School Alliance. Today we're talking to someone who has been inducted into the National Charter School Hall of Fame, Linda Moore, founder of the Elsie Whitlow Stokes Community Freedom Public Charter School. Hi, Linda, and welcome. Please give our listeners, our viewers, a little of your own background.
Well, hello, Ramona. I am Linda Moore, and about 22 years ago now, I was fortunate enough, lucky enough to found the Elsie Whitlow Stokes Community Freedom Public Charter School, which is an elementary school. We serve children from age three in pre-kindergarten through fifth grade. We have a program that emphasizes language immersion. Every one of our students studies in French and English or Spanish and English. And we also emphasize social justice and have emphasized social justice from day one, community service. And so that's pretty much who we are. We have now two campuses for 18, I think, of those 22 years, or maybe 20 of those 22 years, we were a single campus, but now we have two campuses. And as for me, I was originally from Little Rock, Arkansas, and as everybody always asks me when I say that, I was a child during the Little Rock Central High School crisis, and probably much of what I do now is now with the school grows out of my experience then. And the final thing I want to say about myself is actually about the namesake of the school, Elsie Whitlow Stokes. She was my mother. She was a first grade teacher in Arkansas for over 36 years, and she was by far the best teacher that I've ever run into. So I always have to give kudos to my mom.
Well, Linda, tell us, what was public schooling like in the District of Columbia before chartering?
You know, I'm not a native to DC, and I had been in the DC area maybe less than 10 years, I think, before I founded the school. So I will give you my impressions of what I think people were thinking about the schools. Clearly, there was a lot of dissatisfaction, probably in every sector of the city, about the state of the schools at that point. There were some obvious problems that you didn't even have to set foot into the buildings to see. Buildings had just structural issues that needed to be attended to. I cannot recall all the times I've read newspaper articles about schools that had problems with their boiler systems, for example. There was a shortage of supplies. It was clear that there was a lot of teacher dissatisfaction. At the same time, there was dissatisfaction among a lot of the parents about the quality of education for students. It was a typical big city, cookie cutter, one size fits all school district. There was not a great deal of choice in the school system in terms of specialized curricula or curricular to appeal to students with specific and particular interests. I got interested, quite frankly, because my most recent career path had been in education policy, and I'd had the opportunity to look at some schools and visit schools throughout the country. I was committed to education because my mother was a teacher and I couldn't escape it. And I was fortunate enough to be anticipating my first grandchild about the time that I got this bright idea. And I'd started asking myself questions about where he was going to be educated and how he was going to be educated. And so that was part of what I was thinking of.
Absolutely right, leading me right into my next question, which is, What was the point and the purpose of chartering public schools in DC?
People had many different kinds of thoughts. I'm gonna start with what I was thinking about. I have been all of my adult life an advocate for social justice. And I have always seen education as a means to equality, a means to having a better life. My family emphasized the importance of education when I was a child. And so to the extent that I was in schools in the District of Columbia and was aware of some of the things that were going on, aware firsthand, I was concerned about the children in the city and whether they were getting the opportunities that would prepare them to compete, to have good lives in the future. I also, in terms of our curriculum, I had some specific interests based on my life experiences. I had the privilege of working with people who had been doing research on education and what it was children need to know and to be able to do, looking toward the 21st century at that point. And so I had some ideas that were outside of the mainstream DC public school system curriculum, particularly the emphasis on languages, so that our children, you know, don't just learn how to count or learn the colors of languages. They actually learn to speak and read and think and write in languages. And I saw that as a way to, as a means to prepare children for what we were just calling at that point, the 21st century education. But also the emphasis on cultural education and respect for diversity. There was a new world that that many of us were envisioning, and we wanted to prepare our children for that.
Yes, you offer world languages, and I believe your young people also get an opportunity to travel.
They do. They do. This is one of the highlights of their experiences. Every fifth grader in our school is eligible to take what we call an international study tour. It's a week in either Panama or in Martinique, depending on whether they have studied French or Spanish. And they are, our students are paired with a sister school in either of those locations. They attend classes, they do sightseeing, they do a service learning project while they're there. And invariably, our students come back to us, not only right after they've made the trip, but they come back to us years later when they're near adults or adults and tell me that that activity changed their lives. It gave them an outlook on the world. Washington, you know, there are a lot of things to see and do in Washington, D.C., but as much as we think it is the epicenter of the world, it is not the entire world. And our children get to learn that at an early age.
And that's such a wonderful experience. You also, I happen to know, have a garden and prepare your meals. Please explain that.
Yeah, that was a lucky, I would have to say, a lucky happenstance for our school. I think it was a matter of attracting the right people to the school, but we were approached maybe 10 years, maybe more than 10 years ago, by a woman who was a chef who had been interested in preparing home-cooked, good and nutritious foods for schools. And she had approached some of the larger school districts around and had not made any headway because apparently the school districts thought that her model was too complicated for them. We always wanted our children to have nutritious food, and even from the outset, took great pains to contract with vendors who would give us something beyond the typical school lunch program. But this particular chef, it was an easy sale. We wound up hiring her. She built a a fantastic food service program in our school. Any child, regardless of whether they buy their lunch or they bring their lunch, they can partake of the salad bar. It has been it's been a learning experience for our students, but our students very quickly learn that vegetables taste good. And you know, we like that because we are not only trying to help them build healthy minds, but we're trying to help them build healthy bodies. A correlate to that, yes, is our school garden. And we've had our school garden maybe for 15 years now. At every grade level, students are responsible for caring for the garden, for planting, for weeding it, and caring for the garden, for harvesting. In really good years, we get enough of the harvest to supplement what we do in the kitchen and for the preparation of meals. And we've also been able to hold cooking sessions, not only in our after-school program for students, but for parents. And so it's our emphasis on nutrition is really very holistic, and our emphasis on education is holistic. It's not just what one gets out of the out of books, but it's experiential, it's relationships.
And please give us an example of your community or social justice aspects of your work. What kinds of things do kids that age and their teachers and perhaps their families as well, what do they do?
Our whole concept of social justice and how we talk about it has developed over the 22-year period. Initially, we use the term social justice. The activities our children did, the language that we used about around that was more of community service and community service learning, which certainly is a part of social justice. And so initially our students did activities, for example, I think it was a first grade class that was studying animals. And as a part of the learning unit on animals, they engaged with the Heifer Project International, which provides animals, farm animals, for people in other countries to help them raise enough money for food. So, for example, and so our children raised money for, I think, a cow in one location and maybe chickens in another location. And they also wrote letters to the schools, the villages that received these animals. A fifth grade class way back then actually was studying water, was doing a study unit on water. And they came to learn where the water shortages are in the world and some reasons for water shortages and some ways that we can correct those shortages. And one of our parents was originally from Nigeria and was able to identify a village near where she was born and it got our students interested. Again, it was a money-raising thing, but raising money to help to facilitate the drilling of a well for that village. And also there was communication and correspondence with students in that area. More recently, particularly in the year 2000, with all of the emphasis on Black Lives Matter, police brutality. Our students, our faculty, and our parents, and I have to give kudos to our parents, have really worked together to engage our entire school community around issues of equity. We have a school equity team that is led by parents, and the team sponsors projects and activities. But there are also regular convenings of parents and teachers to talk about issues of equity and with the hopes of identifying where the school can do better, where we can do a better job of making sure that all of our students have an equitable opportunity to learn in our school. In last summer, in 2020, our equity team sponsored a Black Lives Matter caravan following the murder of George Floyd. And our parents, our teachers, got in their cars. Everybody, of course, was socially distanced. And they drove through Northeast DC, honking their horns, and they had signs on their car. And it was just an opportunity to make a public statement about what we as a community thought about issues of equity and human rights and social justice. We will have a town hall on equity in February of this year, where students and parents and faculty will be engaged in addressing some of these issues too. So we've advanced. We are still doing community service learning activities, but we have one of the results for our school with our virtual learning and all of the events of 2020 is that it has given our school community an opportunity to focus on issues of social justice. We have developed language that our students can understand easily. We have engaged our parents in finding consensus about their ideas about social justice. And we've also been able to, it's given our teachers an opportunity also to improve their capacity to talk to students about social justice. I know about social justice because I was in Little Rock, Arkansas in the 50s. And I have examples that are personal to me. Not every teacher who we have has that particular background, and especially because a number of our teachers are originally from countries outside of the United States, so they don't even have the same perspective and background that people who were born in the United States have when we talk about social justice. They have social justice issues that they can share with the children. But it is a matter of providing professional development and opportunities for teachers to learn. So while we are not happy about all the challenges that we've had recently, we are pleased that we have had this opportunity to improve ourselves and improve our capacity to teach children about social justice and develop their commitment to social justice.
Elsie Whitlow Stokes is one of the most diverse schools in the city, I understand. Would you explain how that is? Not all of the schools have the diverse student and faculty, family population that you have.
A couple of years ago, the Washington Post actually wrote a story and mentioned the fact that according to their data, we were the most diverse school in Washington, D.C. Our diversity emerges in large measure from our school's mission. The word diverse is in our school mission. We want to serve a diverse group of students. We want to serve students from different racial, ethnic, language, countries of origin, religious, gender backgrounds, because we are trying to prepare our children for the real world. We want our children to be able to engage with everybody.
Well, Linda, going back to chartering and charter schooling beyond Stokes throughout the city, how have things changed over the 20 plus years?
One of the benefits, I think, for having been a pioneer with charter schools in DC is that I indeed have had an opportunity to witness the changes that have happened in our city. DC is about power. DC is about race. Most of the charter schools were led by African Americans. That has changed. It has changed significantly. It has changed with the rapid gentrification of many parts of DC over the last, again, maybe 8 to 10 years. Our first 5 years easily, Actually, our first 6 years, we did not have, we only had one white student. Now some 20% of our students are white. We moved into a neighborhood that was gentrifying. We moved with a lot of opposition, frankly, from the residents. And now I don't think anybody has a problem with us being in the neighborhood. So it is good that that kind of diversity is in our schools, because in some ways in Washington, one could say that charter schools are fulfilling the mandate of Brown versus Board of Education in terms of making quality education available to all children of all races. In other ways, we know that depending on where you live, where a child lives, there are neither good traditional public schools in the neighborhood, nor are they necessarily sufficient good charter schools in the neighborhood. And that's just a way of saying not every child has access to quality education, even at this date. Some 22 years later, 22, 23 years later in the city, I cannot say that quality education is available to all children in the city.
What are your thoughts and feelings and maybe even intentions about the way the change is going and what the future may hold for public education or for charters in DC?
I think that DC has made great strides over the last 20 years. And I think that's something that we can all be proud of. There were some very, very courageous people who worked to make sure that there were enough good schools in DC again. But as I just said, they're not enough good schools, not for all of the children. And so part of my concern for right now is to continue to support those schools that are doing a really terrific job with students, but to somehow, whether we as a city do it with the DC public school system, the traditional school system in the city, whether we do it through charter schools or both, but to really re-energize ourselves around offering opportunities, offering different opportunities for children, more opportunities for the arts, more opportunities for children with special needs. Charter schools, when we were approved for authorized to begin a school, there were two charter schools that offered world languages. One of them does not exist anymore. We have, I think there are five elementary schools now that offer immersion programs for world language, and one middle high school that does that. We can't get enough of that. In my opinion, if not immersion, really extensive languages ought to be available to every child. Higher mathematics, opportunities for global learning. We as a city need to make sure there is no reason in the nation's capital that there should be any child in the city who doesn't get a good education. So that's something that I'd like to see. I'd like to see new energy around that, and not as much conversation about whether a school is a traditional school or whether a school is a charter school. If we know that traditional schools are gonna have more autonomy to do some of the wonderful things that charter schools have been doing. And so, you know, I would challenge our public school leaders to look at how they can make that opportunity available for neighborhood schools and for principals and, you know, for parents to achieve that kind of autonomy. In addition to that, I want to see more community-supported opportunities to celebrate our children who just do incredible work, who are wonderful students. I happen to be one of those people who thinks that all children are brilliant in their own way, and it's a job of the educators to figure out how someone is brilliant and to tap into that brilliance. And one of the ways to encourage children to share their brilliance is actually to celebrate it. And I just think we ought to have celebrations all around the year to recognize our students. So I think those were the two things that I would want to see right now. Three things. Third thing is to help support school leaders, education leaders, whether they are leaders of schools, as in principals, as in executive directors of charter schools, whether they're folks whose jobs involve forming education policy, as in people on city council, as in parent and citizen leaders. We could stand to have a lot of leadership development in the area of schools. So those would be my three.
Three big ones. Mm-hmm. Is there anything else you'd like to share with us before we close out today's interview?
So how about a shout out to all the folks who are doing a good job, whether they are school leaders, whether they're teachers, facilities people, the people who keep the doors open, the parents who are supporting students and teachers, the parents who are supporting their children during this time of a pandemic where most of our students, nearly all of our students, are learning at home, and parents are supporting them while they're working at home or working other places. A big shout out to our parents. So,
absolutely. And a big shout out to Linda Moore.
Thank you.
Thank you so very much, Linda.
Thank you. It's been my pleasure. Thank you
for joining us for this Living History program of the DC Charter School Alliance. Thank you.